Hi, Fiona Weeks with Laurel TV here at the Laurel Library for a very special Black History Month presentation. Lindsey Baker from the Laurel Historical Society, historian Sandra Johnson, and the Prince George's County Library Systems presents Laurel's Black History.
So the way we're going to do this is I'm going to give you a brief overview of early Black history in Laurel, and then, as I told Sandra, no pressure, she's going to steal the show. And we had a conversation about what would be the best presentation for us to give in this brand new, beautiful building. And she mentioned talking about the history of the land that the building is on. And I thought that was a great idea. So I hope you guys agree. That's what she's going to be presenting on. And then at the end, we're going to take questions and answers. Or we're going to take questions, and we're hopefully going to give you answers. And that should be about 8 o'clock we're planning to end. Does that sound good? Okay. So if you were sitting here earlier, you already saw this slide. I'm used to talking to camps and school groups, so I like to interact and ask people questions. So does anyone want to share something that they know about Laurel's Black history? Is it a wide open enough question in the back?
Not yet.
OK. Did you want to share something?
That was a zero.
Okay. Well, hopefully we will change that. So I'm starting like pretty far back, Montpelier Mansion. You can see here, this is a runaway ad for someone near Laurel Factory. If you didn't know this already, before Laurel was incorporated in 1870, it was called Laurel Factory. So we had our name based solely on the mill, which we'll get to later. I'll give you a little brief history of that. And most of this, you know, bigger part of Laurel that you're familiar with, especially South Laurel, was owned by the Snowdens, who did own slaves. You can see some information up there. I'm not very good at reading from the slides. I pulled this information from a presentation that another one of our volunteers gives pretty regularly, and I reread it. I've given this presentation before, and I reread it and was like, wow, that is some really interesting information. So I don't like to read directly from it, but I wanted to just point out, 1817, there was a law passed in Maryland prohibiting slave owners from freeing their slaves. And then they were required in 1831 to leave Maryland within 10 days or pay a fine of $50 a week or be sold into slavery. So it looked like 1831, Elizabeth Snowden tries to find a workaround on that, and how successful she was is, you know, I'm not sure. But in 1858, they allowed slaves over the age of 10 and under the age of 45 to be manumitted. I think that's backwards. I think it was probably under the age of 10 and over the age of 45. They probably didn't let the primary workforce go. In 1860, law passed which prohibited the manumission of slaves. So obviously, this is all building up to the Civil War and them trying to make a point here with people's lives, I want to point out. So real quick, like I said, the mill, if you're not aware of where it stood where the pool is at 9th and Main Street now. That's exactly where the mill stood. And the reason there was a mill is we had a good fall line with the river right there. And we had a lot of workers. When we did the 2012 exhibit on the mill at the Laurel Museum, we were really excited to tell the story of all the immigrant mill workers. That's not who was working in our mill. It was all families. And they came from Maryland, DC, Virginia, Pennsylvania. It was kids from the age, the youngest we found was 6 years old, all the way up to the dad was 49 in that particular family. So everyone in the family was working at the mill. They lived in surrounding houses. If you've ever been to Main Street and been closer towards 9th Street, you're familiar with those houses. The museum is in one of them. And we began as Laurel Factory Town until we were incorporated in 1870 as Laurel. So here's just some brief census information. We get a lot of our information from the census, so please fill out the census so future museum people will be able to tell you all about life in 2017. So you can see in 1860, there were 127 free Black citizens in Laurel out of, 855 were enslaved in the District 1. This is a picture of the Merkirk Ironwork workers. Merkirk was south of Laurel. And within Laurel, the job opportunities for African Americans was farmers, laborers, servants. There wasn't a lot of opportunity in town. Further south, they were able to work in the iron works, but within Laurel, it was really limited. I think you're next. So now I'm going to toss it over to the star of the show. She's really going to tell you guys some great stuff. No pressure.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Sandra Johnson. I grew up in Laurel. I grew up on 10th Street. I'm a member of St. Mark's United Methodist Church across the street. I've been the church historian for quite a while. I have lived all of my adult life, however, in Baltimore. I'm a retired Baltimore City public school teacher. But I always gravitated back when my family's here. I love St. Mark's, so I always came back. And I've always been very interested in history. And once I started studying the history of the church and the community, I said, wow, I just didn't realize the importance of what was going on, the things that you take for granted as a child, but the older you get, you really start to realize the importance of it. So I'm hoping that this presentation tonight will enlighten you about the property we're on right now. So as I said, I would like to reflect upon the importance of this property here where this library stands to the African American citizens and community of Laurel. From the early 1900s until the construction of the library, this property was the site of a school, baseball and softball fields, playground, beauty salon, barbershop, pool room, store, dance hall, apartments, Emancipation Day celebrations, and other community and church-related activities. During Reconstruction and into the 20th century, Prince George's County witnessed a new generation of Black community formation. Like the rest of Prince George's County, Laurel was a segregated community. African Americans gradually began to build their own communities, usually centered around a church and a school. Laurel was no different. This library's location was once the site of a large oak grove where gigantic oak trees, some more than 200 years old, grew. Hence, the local community became known as the Grove. If you talk to anyone from Prince George's County, and that you tell them that you're from Laurel, and sometimes the first thing they would ask you, oh, you're from the Grove, or you're from Halltown, or you're from, you know, every community had their own unique names, but this was known as the Grove. I've been told that the Oak Grove probably extended from Laurel Avenue, right down here, down 8th Street, past northbound Route 198. The facility belonged to the Charles Stanley family. Charles Stanley was married to Margaret Snowden, a descendant of the Snowden family, the founders of Laurel. Charles and other members of his family allowed the sponsors of the various activities to use the property free of charge. In the late 1950s, the Maryland State Road Commission constructed Route 198 through the Oak Grove. And at that time, where Route 198 and 8th Street is located, our church's parsonage was there, and the parsonage was moved adjacent to the church site right now. The Grove was the area to which African Americans were restricted to live in the 1800s. The Grove became the center of Laurel's African American community. If anything was going on in the Grove, it was either being held at St. Mark's or on this property. As stated before, Black communities were centered around a church and a school. St. Mark's United Methodist Church, which is located across the street on the corner of 8th and West Streets, was founded in 1890. The home mission was organized by Frank Carter and his wife, Sarah Hebron Carter. Our pastor is shown is the Reverend Dr. Sonia L. King. In October 2016, St. Mark's celebrated its 126th anniversary. Through church and community activities, meaningful activities were provided for the community's youth. In fact, the church and community leaders provided most of the recreational and leadership activities for people of all ages in Laurel. And that's why the church was just such an integral part of the community, because this is where you did not feel as if you were a second-class citizen. You were able to go there and really not just to, well, to praise God, of course, but just to be in an atmosphere where you just felt safe and you really felt close to your the other people in the community. In the early 1900s, the school system in Prince George's County was completely segregated. Students attended segregated schools, of course. There were 28 schools for black children in the county compared to 60 for white children. Prince George's County Public Schools operated under a dual system that was in keeping with an 1872 Maryland law requiring the separate education of black and white children. According to the African American Heritage Survey from 1996 publication, school number 2, the colored school, was opened in the Grove in 1884. The school was located on West Street, which was near the church, West Street across from St. Mark's. The Grove's children received their grammar school education there. It is now a private residence, and this is a picture of the private residence of today. Together, St. Mark's and school number 2 became the nucleus of the black community of Laurel. School number 2 was a small frame building. As in other schools for colored students, one teacher taught all grades. Pictured is the late Mrs. Bertha Moore, who was a former pupil and later teacher at school number 2. As the number of students increased, an annex was added. Later, the Board of Education rented another building for the black community. It was used until 1930 when the Laurel Grove School was opened. In 1930, the Laurel Grove School was then opened on this property where the parking lot is located. Oh. Really?
Yeah.
Shouldn't be. Okay. Doing things on its own now. Of course, it wouldn't work now. It's going to advance things on its own. The Laurel Grove School serves children from Laurel and Oakcrest. Oakcrest is an African-American community located south of Laurel on Route 1. It was a two-room frame building that held 50 children. I had the pleasure of interviewing seven members of St. Mark's who attended the Laurel Grove School, because I didn't. By the time I was ready to go to school, integration was at its very beginning stages. There are Mrs. Mildred Awkward, Mr. David Burley, Mr. Maurice Carey, Ms. Gail Gibson, George Gibson, Judith James, and Mr. George Still. And Mr. George Still was the first African-American graduate of a Laurel High School, first male. The first graduate was in 1959, it was a lady who was from the Merkirk area in Beltsville, but Mr. Still was the first African-American male graduate of Laurel High School in 1961. Their ages range from 67 to 92. Some attended the Grove School for their entire elementary school experience. Others attended only until they transferred to either O.W. Fair Elementary or Laurel Elementary School. How many of you still remember O.W. Fair? Right, okay, because it was near where the Laurel Municipal building is. Mm-hmm. The interview session was quite enlightening. They described the building as a wooden frame building consisting of 2 classrooms and 2 bathrooms in the middle. The students brought packed bag lunches because, of course, there was no cafeteria at that time. One classroom was for first, second, and third grades, the other for fourth, fifth, and sixth. It is worth noting that Mrs. Mildred Awkward, who was 92, said during her time, the school went to the seventh grade. And she also stated while in the seventh grade, students had to take a state test to qualify to attend high school. Black students from Lakeland, which is in College Park, all the way up to Laurel, were tested at the elementary school in Rossville on Merkirk Road in Beltsville. If students did not pass the test, they could not attend high school. And at that time, they were going to Lakeland High School in College Park. And then when in 1950, when Fairmont Heights High School opened in Capitol Heights, then they started going there. And of course, and it's so strange if you know where the original Laurel High School is, where the Phelps Center, the Laurel Boys Club, I mean, that was a 5-minute walk from the Grove. I mean, the school was just right there. And at that time, with the schools being segregated, they just could not just walk 5 minutes to school. You had to get on a bus, or not necessarily a bus, because at that time also, Prince George's County did not provide free bus transportation for black students, as I was told. The students had to either catch the bus or the train down to Lakeland High School, which meant that if your parents could not afford for you to send you, for you to, you know, pay that commuter fee each day, then your chances of completing high school really wasn't that great. All of those agreed they received a good basic education at the Laurel Grove School. They also reflected on the kindness and compassion of the teachers. Four teachers were fondly remembered: Ms. Hill, Mr. Mack, Ms. Major, and Ms. Smith. They mentioned how the teachers would take students to their homes to spend the weekend. And being a former teacher, when they told me that, I said, my goodness, if that happened today, you would see these people on the 6 o'clock news. But you know, the farm remembrances, things like that. Even with the obstacles that segregation presented, the teachers were able to achieve success with the students. Laurel schools began to slowly integrate in 1955. However, there were parents who decided to still keep their children in the Laurel Grove School. These parents were apprehensive about how their children would be treated by the white teachers, administrators, and classmates. Children who lived on 9th and 10th Streets went to O.W. Fair near the Laurel Municipal Building, and those living on West and 8th Streets went to Laurel Elementary. It was interesting how the experiences of those who attended O.W. Fair were more positive than those who attended Laurel Elementary. The Laurel Elementary interviewee stated that it was sometimes rough trying to fit in. For some African-American students, integrating the schools in Laurel was not always an easy process. They felt as if the teachers at O.W. Fair were friendlier and more receptive to African-American children. Laurel Elementary was located in the heart of Laurel on Montgomery Street. And you have to remember that at the time, Laurel was a somewhat segregated city. So they had the impression that maybe the neighborhood surrounding Laurel Elementary was still trying to hold on to the old way of life. In 1962, the Prince George's County Board of Education closed the Laurel Grove School. The building was then used by the Laurel Cooperative Kindergarten Head Start Program. After the county sold the property to the city of Laurel, the school building was torn down and the building was converted into a park. It was unfortunate when the building was demolished. It was hurtful, but at least the land still remained a part of the Grove. The Laurel Grove School is fondly remembered for the major part the community played in all its activities. I think they've. So just keep pressing till it all comes on. Yeah. Okay, I got you. To those in the Grove, this property was known as the school ground. Not only was the school lake located there, this was also where children went to play on the swings, sliding board, and other playground equipment. The basketball court, baseball, and softball fields were also there. This was a gathering place for all the residents of the Grove. Oh, didn't get it all. Okay. Since 1902, Emancipation Day in Laurel has been an annual celebration commemorating the Emancipation Proclamation when President Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves in America. And if you're familiar with Laurel, you know that St. Mark's, you know, we always have a large celebration at that time. In first Saturday in September. This was the major annual event held on this property in the Laurel Grove. Emancipation Day is Laurel's oldest festival. The Emancipation Celebration keeps the community spirit alive and promotes togetherness. In its beginning, on a Saturday in September, the fraternal orders of the community and the church sponsored the Emancipation Celebration picnic jointly in the Old Oak Grove. St. Mark's eventually became the sole sponsor. Relatives and friends came from far and near to share in the festive celebration. It was a reunion for those who had moved beyond the city's boundaries. This photograph is from the 1910 celebration from the parade. As a historian of St. Mark's, I had the pleasure of interviewing these four persons in the 1990s. They have all passed away since that time. They provided so much firsthand knowledge of the Emancipation celebrations of the past. Crowds from Washington and Baltimore, as well as elsewhere in the surrounding counties, gathered yearly in the grove trees where Route 198 now runs to picnic and play baseball. Streetcars ran every 15 to 20 minutes from Washington to Laurel on Emancipation Celebration Day. All of the different churches in the area attended. There were live bands, and vendors came from the city to sell jewelry and other items. In the early days, people arrived in the Grove in their horse-drawn buggies on Friday evenings. By Saturday morning, the Oak Grove was filled with people and vendors. Some would stay until Sunday. There were all kinds of foods and activities that went on the entire day. Youngsters and adults enjoyed a day of feasting on fried chicken, greens, corn on the cob, sweet cakes, and ice cream. Then they ran off to play games, watch the baseball games, ride, as they call them, to ride the flying horses, or enjoy the marching bands in the parade. The parade was certainly the highlight of the day. The parade began on 8th Street and moved through Main Street in downtown Laurel. There were attractions for adults as well as children. A dance for adults was held that night when the band played until midnight. Everyone in the Laurel community looked forward to the celebration with gleeful anticipation. I don't think you can find any African American in this surrounding area that doesn't know that the Emancipation Celebration is held on the first Saturday in September. I mean, it's been that way for decades. And as I remember as a child, just the excitement of just knowing that it was coming, because you wondered which bands were coming and what type of food they were going to have and who was going to be playing in the games. I mean, you know, even through my childhood, it was such a great celebration, a great day. On September 7th, 1991, during a dedication ceremony, the 3-acre park was officially renamed Emancipation Park by the city of Laurel. Shown in this picture is the late Mrs. Bernice Brooks. She's at the podium. Mrs. Brooks was the rock of this community, of this Laurel Grove community, for many years. She just passed away at the age of about 94, about a year ago. We used to call her the mayor of the Grove because she was the one who attended the city council meetings to represent the residents of the Grove. And for those of you who are older, you may recognize Mrs. Brooks. Also pictured is I believe, Mayor Craig Moe is in this picture as well. Uh-huh. And our pastor at that time was Reverend George F. DeFord. The Emancipation Day celebration continues today, as I said, on the first Saturday in September. Until 2015, when the library construction began, the celebration was held on this site. Now the Emancipation Day celebration is held on a large lot across from St. Mark's, right across the street that we own a piece of property. Now we have the celebration there. Like other areas of life, sports and recreation were also segregated. Consequently, young black men formed their own teams and communities. Baseball was a popular sport among Prince George's County African American residents. The Laurel Stars, an all-black sandlot baseball team, played here from the 1920s to the early 1960s, during an era when opportunities to perform in the white minor and major leagues were at first non-existent and later limited. The Laurel Stars played their home games on this property in the old oak grove. It was not the promise of money or fame that motivated the Stars. These men simply loved the game of baseball. The Stars was a community team that drew players from a 10-mile radius. Home games from the Laurel Stars were community events. The teams competed against each other and traveled throughout the region, often accompanied by fans. Forming their own teams and leagues was just one strategy African Americans utilized to assert themselves. About 200 or 300 fans would come to games during the summer, and the crowd would increase to 1,000 for the annual Emancipation Day game against other all-African American local teams. The games were exciting, and the crowd was always enthusiastic. Since the Stars did not make their living in baseball, and most had full-time jobs and families to tend to during the week, games were played on Sunday after church was over. The surviving members of the Laurel Stars were honored during the Emancipation Day ceremonies and parade on September 6, 1999. And I'm trying to, maybe you can help me, Mike. I think all of them basically have passed except about one since that time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. There were also many girls and men's softball games played here as well. Just like the Laurel Stars, they competed against other area teams from Prince George's, Howard, Montgomery, and Anne Arundel counties. The field would be filled with spectators and fans. The opposing team was also accompanied by their fans as well. The Laurel community was so supportive. These games provided an opportunity for people to gather together and root for the home team. I do remember, because the softball teams have been going on for decades, but when I played, I really wasn't one of the stars. I was just wanting to be on the team. But it was something, a lot of our games were during the week, and it seemed like everybody knew when the games were going to be happening. And even after a hard day of work, and as Lindsey mentioned, most of the residents in this grove were laborers or domestics and things like that. And even after a hard day, they just came. They were so supportive at the games because it was a time to gather and just and not just wait until Sunday to see people at church. You had an opportunity, you know, to come out during the week and not only fellowship with one another, but also enjoy a good game. On this exact location, and I believe the address was 600 8th Street, there was a large building, and it was located near 198, exactly basically where we're seated at this point. Older residents recall that there were dances held at the hall on Sundays after church. William Carey and his father, Roscoe Carey, purchased the building in 1963. The deed lists the owners as Ralph Parker, Charles Matthews, Benjamin Adams, Lawrence Thompson, and Casper Thomas, who were the trustees of the Knights of Pythian's Lodge of Laurel. When the building was first purchased, there was a beauty salon, barbershop, store, pool room, and dance hall. This building served many purposes. These were black-owned businesses that provided worthwhile and needed services to Laurel and other surrounding black communities. The building was eventually renovated into a three-apartment structure. The apartments remained there for many years until Mr. Carey sold the building in 2012 to Prince George's County to construct this new library. Mr. Carey was pleased that his property would be used to benefit the entire Laurel community. To prepare the property for library construction, the apartment building was demolished and the Emancipation Park was cleared. It was a very emotional sight to see. Mrs. Joan Moore, a senior St. Mark's member, says she cried when she saw it. She was saddened that so many memories for her and her children were gone. A large part of the Grove's history was gone. I know how I felt the first time I drove down when I turned from Montgomery Street and I came down A Street and I could just see all the way down to 198, and my first reaction was, wow. You know, just to, after riding down for many, many years and seeing the trees and that building, and just to see all of it just cleared and flattened, it was something. But don't get me wrong, I'm pleased that this library has been placed in this community. Our children, youth, and other Laurel residents will have easy access to this beautiful and much needed facility. Even though the community was pleased that the new library would be built, there was a void left because of the disappearance of a community landmark. This park was the place where we gathered to celebrate the accomplishments of each other, St. Mark's, and the community. Many generations have enjoyed and cherished the activities and events held here. I admire those early residents who spent many years building a church and a community for all of us to appreciate and enjoy. This original home of that large oak grove and its illustrious history has had so many memories for African Americans in Laurel spanning over 130 years. So at this time, Lindsey, I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to have shared this reflection with everyone. And I'd also like to thank my St. Mark's family for supporting me and for also, you know, giving me a lot of added information, because sometimes with, I don't know about any history, but sometimes with African American history, a lot of it was not written down. So you really have to get it for, and sometimes it may be better when you get it firsthand. And because some of the things I was able to get from research, and I'm still looking for a picture of the Laurel Grove School. And if I had known when I was younger that it would, you know, I would like to have a picture, I would have taken a picture of, but no one has a picture of that school. And I've looked in through the county and all that, and I've never been able to find a picture of the Laurel Grove School. But as I said, I'm hoping that this small information just gives you an insight as to how this property, what it meant to the Grove area, and we're just looking forward to a new beginning for this library and for our community. So thank you for your time.
I told you guys she was going to steal the show.
See, I came to Laurel in 1961, and so a lot of time has passed that I had missed things. I didn't remember the building that being here in the 1990s that was an apartment building, and that really has me scratching my head.
I was happy to see that there were so many people interested and all ages, both black and white, you know, asking really good, interesting questions. So I was happy to see that. I also took away that the history in the area is still that people are really interested in what happened a long time ago. It's not just about now, it's about how we got to now.